Good afternoon, everyone. I want to welcome all of you to what I feel is one of the best events during Congressional Black Caucus Annual Legislative Conference. And that is something that I created 30 years ago entitled Young, Gifted, and Black. Many of you know that I'm indeed a strong supporter of our young people who are pursuing careers in the music industry and in other phases of our life. And it is really my honor to host this event every year. During this panel, we celebrate not only, you know, the Black artists who are producing, singing, directing, but we also celebrate, young Black people in other fields that are doing other things. Of course, it started out with music, but we also honor those who are in education, who are in health, who are in sports, et cetera. The main emphasis is on young Black people, artists who are musicians. But again, we enjoy having others in other fields come along with us because they too are young, gifted, and Black. And so we have people who are breaking the mold in every genre of music and honoring the legacy of music in our community. Now, there's no denying that I certainly would love to be with all of you in person, sharing in community, hearing and witnessing our artists freestyle, drop some beats or sing a melody. But the fact is that the pandemic is not over. COVID-19 is still here. And now with all of these variants on the rise, we must do everything we can to protect one another and keep us all safe and healthy. At this point, this isn't anything new. Throughout the pandemic, we found new ways to connect to the world and to one another. And there's no denying that music has certainly helped us to stay grounded and has guided us through our emotions over the last year. And that's what I love about music and young people who are energetic and have thoughts about the future. They inspire us and seeing young people shine with their God-given talents. And so despite the fact we can't be together in a packed room, the show must go on. And we're going to make the best of this technology and have a little fun. So again, Young, Gifted, and Black is very special. And it has emerged as one of the most listened to and watched and participated in activities of this conference. And I want you to know that we usually open with Nina Simone singing Young, Gifted, and Black because it has so much soul in it. It says so much. And so let's go on today with our artists that are going to be with us, some very special people. And I'm looking forward to sharing them with you. So thank you so much. Let's get started. Let me just thank you for responding. And I'd like to say to you that you have had a wonderful career and it's really just at its peak as far as I'm concerned, because you have been producing, contributing, and you have put out some wonderful things that people are realizing now, even that this is not just new for you. How did you get started?
I got started very early in the church. I knew early that I wanted to sing, that I love singing. I love the feeling of being on the pulpit, being on stage, and the connection that you get with people. There's a connection that happens where people feel seen, where you feel like they understand you and your lyrics and what you're singing about. And that's just a feeling that I never wanted to give up. And so I literally can't do anything else but music. That's the only thing I could do. Because I knew early, like, this was what I wanted my life to be, what I felt my calling was. And that just grew as I got older. I know for sure that that is what God wants me to do.
Well, you know, it's so interesting because Tone said his inspiration came from church too. His mother was in the choir, and that one of the things he said was when he first had to perform, and he said he'd been watching his mother do it, I guess, since he was a little bitty thing, and he thought that it was easy. And when he had to do it, he was scared to death. And
he was nervous.
But, you know, I'm learning from Black artists that a lot of the inspiration really did start in church. And you're not the only ones. When you talk about Aretha Franklin and Gladys Knight and some of those older, they all started in church. Tone?
Yes, ma'am.
You're just, what, 20? Are you 23 or 24?
I'm 26. Oh, I didn't want to correct you, though, because you gave me
2 years. Oh, my goodness, 26 years. Oh, ah.
So you think you grown?
Listen, I'll take 24.
And so, Jasmine, what I was saying to him was, you know, when you're young and you're in school and you have started already knowing and understanding that you love music and that someday you want, you know, to perform, and you've got to do your schoolwork, and everybody's saying, you know, they want you to bring home good grades, and you're sitting up there listening to the teacher, but your mind is wandering. You're wondering about, you know, some words that's coming into your head that you're going to put into a song and all of that. Did your mind wander while you were in school, Tom?
Oh, absolutely. I remember they had to take me to the ADHD facility to get tested. They were like, something's up with him. He's just not here with us. But no, I think to piggyback on what Jasmine was saying, I knew I had a purpose. And I knew that's what I wanted to do. I knew this is the only thing I was put on this earth for. So that's all I was thinking about.
So, and that's another thing that I'm realizing, that whenever it is you realize that this is what you want to do, that's a special moment kind of in your life, a time in your life. And it brings you to the point where no matter what anybody says, this is what I'm going to do. I've got to do this. And it sounds like you hit that moment and you knew it when it came. And so you've been on it since then. And I want to talk a little bit about the honor that you received as a young artist, given the stage at BET. But I want to ask about Tragic. Where'd that come from? Where did Tragic come from, Jasmine?
Ooh, I didn't know you were going to ask about Tragic, man.
Don't worry. Tragic. Listen. Hey. I know everything. Like I tell my kids, I know everything. I've been around for a long time. You can't shock me. You can't surprise me. I'm real. That's right. Okay. All right.
Listen, and that's what I appreciate about you, is that you're so open. You know, listen, we feel like we could talk to our auntie and tell her about anything, and she know what we've been through. So Tragic, unfortunately, is, I think, a position that a lot of females have been in, where they have a lover and the lover just doesn't deliver. And it's really about reclaiming your time. It's about saying what it is that you want. It's about being vocal and honest about your needs. And I feel like as women, we put ourselves last in so many situations, and that carries on even in the bedroom. We put ourselves last. It's all about the man, what they want. We got to appeal to them and do everything that they want, and they don't think about us. And this song is like, no, I know what I want. I know what I want you to do, and I know how I want you to do it, and you better do it, or you don't deserve my time. You don't deserve me, or you don't deserve my time if you don't care about that. So it's really just about reclaiming your time and just, you know, speaking up for yourself.
One more thing. I watched your mom as she was looking at you, and I just know how proud she felt and how she was watching her little girl. And thinking about you growing up, and look at you now on this big stage. And I just know how that must have felt. When do you think your mom really understood who you were and what you really wanted to do?
Well, listen, my mom believed in me before I even did. Like, my mom saw something in me before I could even recognize it. And I really think that was the difference between me making it and continuing on sometimes, because she had to push me sometimes when I really just didn't think I had anything to give, is having a parent who was supportive of your dreams. I mean, it's so important. I stress this to parents, to pay attention to your child, see what it is that drives them, what they love to do, what they want to do in life, and like, and believe in them, because you could be the difference between them succeeding in life or them not at all. So my mom definitely was my backbone, still is my backbone, still she still pushes me to this day. Like, no, you could, if I tell her, I would be like, I can't do that, mom. She's like, girl, there's nothing you can't do. And that's the support that I had and I've always had. And I want everybody to experience that.
That is fabulous. I'm going to go to tone a little bit here because I remember you telling me that showing interest early on in music and you got those drums. I think your mom got you some drums.
Right.
And,
right.
Well, let me just ask you this. Do you think that you learned the beat coming from 3 years old with those drums?
I definitely learned the beat. I remember she would just play Aretha Franklin, she would play Chaka Khan, Patti LaBelle. I just be in the living room, just doing my thing, just grooving. but I knew, I was like, this is it. I love this music. I love the feeling that it's giving me.
So what does it feel like when a beat comes in your head and you got to think of, hey, come on, what does it feel like?
I gotta lay it down. I'm also a producer too. So I first started producing at the age of 11. And that's when I really got into it. But whenever I hear a beat, I'm like, look, I got to lay this down, whether it's like a voice memo on my phone where I just got to lay the idea down and get back to it later or just go right to the computer. But I'm always ready.
Well, I want to hear something. I want to hear something.
Oh, you want to hear a beat?
Yeah.
We can get right to it. I don't got no drums, but we can get right to it.
Yes.
Listen, I'm waiting because it seemed like you got it.
And so Jasmine talked about her mother really realizing her talent and her possibilities before she did. Mm-hmm. What about your mom? What did she think about everything you doing and how you got to where you are? What is she thinking about?
My parents are, like Jasmine said, they are the sole reason as to why I'm where I'm at. They've been pushing me. They've always been supportive. I remember I was in a group as a teenager, and they would literally take the group to all the shows, take us to rehearsal. I remember my mom had us outside in the heat rehearsing, singing. Nope, that note was wrong. Do it again. Nope, that move looked off. Do it again. But I can't stress that enough. You know, your parents being your backbone and being that support is a big reason as, you know, and how you make it in your career and how serious you take it. And just having that support is unmatched.
Well, that's great. And, you know, even though I talk a lot about, you know, in the beginning of rap music and the hardcore and all of that, you're coming from a bit of a different place as I see it. How do you describe your genre?
Like we were saying in the beginning, I come from church. I grew up listening to all gospel. I grew up listening to Jasmine. I think, being that R&B person, it's a different approach on it. And we just got to tell the same story, you know, as the hip hop artist, but it's a different approach to it.
Well, I'm going to ask Jasmine, because she's got a few minutes left, to talk about if you're at the top now, and you have experienced, what it means to be in production and in studios and working with people and people who, are helpful, people who, mess up your spirit, et cetera, et cetera. You have any advice for Tone?
I mean, he seems to have a good head on his shoulders. I would say don't take anything too hard. Be very light. But also care about your music, care about your content and what you put out. Mm-hmm. Don't do anything that you don't feel in your heart is right to do musically. Yeah. Stay close to the people who love you the most and who love you regardless of if you're singing or not. You need those people to keep you grounded. The bigger you get, you run into some weirdos.
Well, you know, Tone was talking about love and production, and I have this sense that you are very much involved in your own production, that you know what you want and you know how to define it, and you get what you want because you know what you want in that production. Is that true?
I do. Listen, when I go into the studio, and especially lately, it's just me and the engineer, and we rock out, we make that song. I was next door to a rapper in Philly, and he came over to my session. He was like, "Where the people at? You don't have nobody here with you?" I said, "I don't need nobody. Like, it's just me and this music." Right. And I don't need all the hype, all the flash. And I love, it's my art. It's my presentation, it's my art. And nobody can say what I have to say better than me. And nobody can paint this picture better than me, as far as I'm concerned. So yes, I'm in control of everything. And thankfully I've been with the label RCA that respects me enough to let me kind of just do my thing, and I wouldn't have it any other way. So.
Well, that's fabulous. And so Tone is a producer. And
he's a producer.
And are you working with some other people, young people also?
As of right now, I'm working with other writers and producers, but as of right now, I've just been working on my next album, my next project, and just lining up everything that I got going in the future.
Let me just ask you, because I've been paying attention to a few things, and when young people are talking about when is the album gonna drop, and Kanye has had 2 listening sessions, and his hasn't dropped yet, and mm-hmm. so they keep waiting for it to drop. Is that pressure? Is that pressure when you start talking about?
I don't think it's pressure at all, because I think it builds up the intensity and the. You know, just the weight, you know, it makes it more exciting. And for me, I just stopped announcing like, oh, on this date, this is coming out. It's just more so like, hey, it's out. You know, just doing the surprise drop. I love that approach to it, but there's no pressure at all.
So what is a listening session all about?
I think listening sessions are very good because, you can get people in the room, and it's not everybody, but you can get some people in the room and you can really get opinions on what people feel about this new music, and it's very intimate, so you can really talk to people, you can really learn what the feedback is.
And so Jasmine, again, I want to thank you, and I know that you have some limited period of time, and you've been here with us, and you have shared with us some of your feelings about music and about yourself. And one of the good things about having young, gifted, and Black is all of a sudden you become real to a lot of people who, just have not heard you talk about yourself. They may know your music, but they don't know whom you are and, what you're all about and where you came from. You know, a lot of the young people think y'all all started rich and that, you had everything that you needed and people invested a lot of money and all of that. And when they get to hear you talk, and I love it when you talk about your parents and that support and the moment that you realize that you were talented and all of that, this makes you real. And this makes you touchable and relatable and all of that. So I want to thank you so much for being with us today. This is Young, Gifted, and Black. This is 2021. And I want you to know that you have graced us with your presence. And this will be so well received by thousands of people in this country who got to know Jasmine today.
Oh, thank you so much.
You are 26 years old. Wow.
Wow.
Wow. But I want you to know there are a lot of young people who are looking to promote and advance and realize their talent. And both of you today are saying you can do it. If you really believe that you've got talent, pursue it. And don't let anybody take it away from you. You work at it, you dream about it, you think about it, you get on other people's nerves about it, but you keep pushing. And that's what I think is one of the great lessons for today. And I wanna thank you so much for being on Jasmine. I know that you have to leave. Love you, looking forward to, I'm gonna follow you. And I'm going to hope that you find some more words of mine to include in your music.
Wait, before I go, though, because they didn't get this, how much I love you, how much you mean to our community and Black women, and why I was so honored. I'm honored to be here now. I was so honored to have you on the stage for BET. And I told you that everybody was going to go crazy when you came up, and you didn't believe me. And I was like, oh, she doesn't know what she means to us, and really what specifically what she means to Black women. And taking up space and not letting anybody push you around and like speaking up for yourself. That is everything for us. And it just inspires us so much to do it for ourselves. And we just love you. We love that you speak for the underdogs. We love that you speak from your heart. We love that you speak for what's right. Wow. No matter who you're speaking to, you're gonna speak for what's right. And you're just amazing. You're an icon. And I'm grateful to be in your presence. I'm grateful to be in your presence.
Thank you for your generosity in speaking about me. You don't know how good that makes me feel to hear you speak those words. And of course, I have people who are complimentary, but you know, we have a lot of people who are haters and who don't like a strong Black woman who will do as you said, challenge and confront. But when I hear you say you love it, that's all I need. And then I say to them, if you come for me, I'm coming for you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. So Tone, you didn't know you were going to have so much fun with an older lady, did you?
Oh, no, I knew it was going to be awesome.
Well, you know, I said, having you on is my do-over. Because I want you to know, not only do I respect you, I love your talent and your music.
Thank you.
I just think that not only do you have a lot to offer, but just thinking about your age and how far you have come so far to be recognized in the way that you're being recognized speaks volumes about what you do and who you are and what you have worked for. So I'm just so delighted to do my do-over and let you know that you're special and you're important and I enjoy you and I love that smile. Today, you have an opportunity to have a lot of other young people feel you and get to know you by just being here and sharing with us, where you started, how you felt, talking about your parents and all of that. And I know that you have thoughts about your future and, you know, other things that you're doing and you're working on. And like you said, you're working on an album now. Is that right?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. I'm definitely working on an album.
And you're feeling good about it?
I'm so excited. I think at this point in my life, I've been signed since I was 16 and in and out different deals and things like that. But at this point in my life, everything is just so lined up perfectly and so right on track that I'm just so excited for the future and what's to come.
Well, that's great. And I wanna ask you, how do you stay grounded? You know, because the more you do, the more you become known, the more people pull at you and the more the forces come at you. What do you do to say, you know, there's some things I'm not going to do and there's some places I'm not going to be? How do you hold on to that?
I really think that just goes back to like we talked about before, my parents and just how I was raised and the examples that they set to make me the man I am today, and just how strong my mother is and what she does and just seeing her operate, seeing my dad operate, I think that just made me who I am. And I don't ever hold back. I always contact them, even in the moments where it's like, you know, I'm not sure about what's going on right now, or I'm worried, or I'm scared of what's happening right now. I always reach out to them and get their perspective. And I'm also a God-fearing man, and I pray. So that's what keeps me centered and grounded, and I keep moving forward.
That's a wonderful message. And I think that a lot of young people listening to you will take that to heart, you know, and I appreciate the fact that you dare to just say, I'm God-fearing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I have no shame in that.
And then, you know, aside from your own interest and, you know, like you said, having listened to all those old 78s and 45s that your mom and dad played, where else do you get inspiration?
You know, when I travel, I love to go places, you know, hiking or the ocean. I love the ocean. That's just one of the many places I go to just kind of clear my mind. I don't answer my phone, just take a break from everything going on. And then, you know, I got to give it to my two all-time favorites, Michael Jackson and Prince. And I can't put one above the other, but though they have been very, very crucial to my career. I was introduced to both of them at the age of 8, not in person, but as far as music.
Wow.
And, since I heard them in my life, it's just been like, oh my gosh, I got to be like that. And I've always studied their catalog just throughout. I know so much of their music, but that's really the driving force.
Okay, so tonight, I think I get an opportunity to see one of my grandsons. And when I tell them that I was on with Antonio Stitt, and they're going to say, Grandma, why didn't you let me come on with you? And I'm going to say, no, this was all mine. And this is young, gifted, and black. This is my time. But this is my time with some of the most fabulous people that I've ever come in contact with, and you're one of them. This is my time to learn more and to appreciate more and to be able to have a conversation and say, well, you know, when I was talking with Tone, this is what Tone said.
Right. No, and it's an honor. I just want to say it's an honor to be here. I'm so grateful. So grateful. Thank you for having me.
Well, you're so welcome. Maybe we can do it again sometime.
Oh, whenever you want. Listen, I could come through, perform, whatever you want me to do, I'm here.
Oh, my God. Thank you so much. And I appreciate that. And I think I'm going to be calling on you, okay?
Yes, I'll be waiting.
So I want to just thank you so much for taking time out and being patient with us today and staying here until we were able to connect, that it was so very important. And so, again, not only my thanks to you, but I want you to keep on going and to realize whatever dreams you may have about your work and where you want it to go and how you're going to be able to help others. Because that's very important too, that there are a lot of people out there who may not have even some of the opportunities that you have, but they're listening and they're watching, and you're going to be able to help them too.
And thank you for doing all you have done in history and being one of the people that spoke out, because that, like Jasmine says, that motivates our generation to come forth and speak out and be strong and you know, empowered. So thank you. I really appreciate it.
Well, you're so welcome with the inspiration that you all bring to me. When I get to Washington, I might take everybody on.
Come on.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
God bless you. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And God bless you also. And I look forward to seeing you and being with you again at some point in time. Okay?
Yes. In person, hopefully.
Okay. Yes. All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Take care.